August 1890. The murderer is about to pay the ultimate price.
This won't hurt, Bill.
The man behind the instrument of his death is one of history's most brilliant inventors.
Edison genuinely believed he was doing a public service.
His execution would be the first of a radical new method of capital punishment, the electric chair.
There was this idea that electricity could be painless.
But did Edison have another motive?
There's this battle over who's going to control this incredible new technology in the United States.
From the start, the world's first execution by electric chair went horribly wrong. Throughout history, significant chapters have brought together a brilliant individual, a crucial situation, and an innovative technology. Man, moment, machine. On the 6th of August, 1890, in New York State's Auburn Prison, witnesses took their seats as convicted axe murderer William Kemmler was prepared for execution. It marked the beginning of a new era in capital punishment and ignited a controversy still alive today.
The question wasn't whether Kemmler was guilty or not. It was whether electricity should be used to put him to death. And there was a lot of controversy about this. Was it really humane?
Hi, I'm Hunter Ellis. And this is William Kemmler's destination, the electric chair. As brutal as it looks, for most people, the chair represents a more civilized means of execution, especially when compared to the alternatives.
Everyone was aware of the things that could go wrong with hanging, which was the most popular method for killing people in those days. They had seen or they'd read about people who had slowly strangled to death at the end of the rope. They'd read about ropes breaking and people having to be hanged over again.
By the late 1800s, public hanging spectacles in America were becoming an embarrassment.
At the hangings of certain notorious criminals, thousands of people would come from miles around. They'd bring their families, they'd make a day of it in town. In one execution in Kentucky, over 20,000 people turned out to see it.
The rudimentary methods of execution clashed with the new developments in technology.
This is the age of invention. Everything's new. Everything's fresh, from the possibility of manned flight to the first automobiles rolling through the streets. And electricity is the greatest example of that. It represents power. It represents the future.
But the miracle of electricity did not come without its dangers.
Do we want an electrical current that can spread electricity across the country, electrify homes? The drawback is people are going to be killed. Every year, linemen would be killed. Even today, people are electrocuted.
In the 1890s, the spread of electricity inspired debate about new methods of imposing the death penalty.
There is a constant search for a better way to kill prisoners, and this idea of electrocuting them became the big idea of the 1890s.
As the turn of the 19th century approaches, America's obsession with electricity is due in large part to the vision and ingenuity of one man, Thomas Edison.
There's going to be electric sewing machines, electric elevators. Everybody's terribly excited about this revolutionary new form of electric light. And the reason people believed it is because this was Thomas Edison.
I think one of the great misconceptions of him was that he was just an inventor. Edison realized building a light bulb was not enough. He created an entire industry around the light bulb. He had generating factories. He had lamp factories. He dug cables under the streets of New York. Edison was a master systems builder.
The technology at the core of Edison's electrical system was called direct current. DC, or low power current, was literally pushed in a single direction from the power generating plant to homes and businesses nearby. But Edison wasn't the only man fighting for the right to wire America.
George Westinghouse is born almost exactly the same time as Edison. When Westinghouse sees all of the excitement surrounding the electric light, he wants a piece of it. He decides that he's going to get into the electric light business too.
George Westinghouse's electrical system was based on a competing technology called alternating current. AC systems work by vibrating current back and forth, rather than pushing it long distances. This gives alternating current some distinct advantages.
You could step the current up to high voltage, transmit it very long distances, and then step it back down to drive whatever electrical apparatus, motor, or lighting that you had.
But alternating current's strength also brings with it a serious drawback. Running at 1,000 volts, contact could be lethal.
When you were raising it to higher voltages in order to transmit it long distances, could hurt people, there's no doubt about it.
Direct current, transmitted at 100 to 200 volts, was considered the safer technology. But it too had a weakness.
There was a limit to how far you could distribute DC systems, about a mile, square mile. If you want to string the lights out into the suburbs, you need a system that can distribute much further.
Direct current versus alternating current. Edison versus Westinghouse. The public would have to make the choice.
The stakes were so unimaginably high. Millions and millions, if not billions of dollars were invested in this game, and Edison really wanted to win the game. If he could set the standard, if he could get direct current used, his company would be the one to set the standard.
1887 is really the year when Edison first realizes that George Westinghouse poses a very serious threat. Now, that same time, he happens to get this letter from Alfred P. Southwick asking for his opinion about electricity.
Southwick, a dentist from Buffalo, was an avid supporter of the death penalty. An article in the local newspaper reporting an accidental electrocution had given him an idea. Electricity would be a perfect way to execute prisoners.
He sends a letter to Thomas Edison, the most famous electrician of the day, seeking both his opinion and really his endorsements.
But Edison, a man openly opposed to the death penalty, dismissed Alfred Southwick's first letter. By the time of Southwick's second letter, Edison began to see how a change of opinion might help his business interests.
Thomas Edison has this devious idea that he could make people believe that alternating current is too dangerous to have in their homes.
If he can make people equate alternating current electricity with death, Thomas Edison believes DC will win the war of the currents and make him a very rich man.
He writes back to him and says, electricity can be a humane way of executing prisoners. And if you want to do this, the most efficient machines for the purpose are those created by George Westinghouse, Pittsburgh.
It's a very shrewd business move. The idea is that people will start thinking, electric chair uses alternating current. Alternating current kills you. And Edison basically sweeps his moral qualms under the carpet and starts supporting the death penalty in an effort actually to get his business to do better.
But for Edison's plan to succeed, the American public would need a human demonstration. 250 miles away in Buffalo, fate was about to deliver one. In the early hours of the 29th of March, 1889, street vendor William Kemmler's temper was shifting from simmering depression to boiling rage. His uncontrollable jealousy was about to set him on the path to history, linking him forever with one of the greatest inventors of all time. In 1889, the electric chair was at the center of a conflict, one that would give America a new form of capital punishment and determine the future of its most famous inventor. Thomas Edison had just been given an opportunity to win the battle to wire America. The country's first electrical execution would soon have its first candidate. As for the electric chair, that was still only a germ of an idea. On the morning of the 29th of March, 1889, a street vendor, a man known for his temper, sat in a bar simmering with rage.
William Kemmler is a semi-successful vegetable peddler living in Buffalo, New York, with his common-law wife, Tilly Ziegler. He is, by all accounts, a terrible drunk, and one morning, out of jealousy, he suspects Tilly of sleeping with one of his employees.
No, Billy. No!
Kills her extremely brutally, like smashes her skull to pieces, and then goes out to have his morning drink at about 8 o'clock in the morning. He admits that morning that he killed her, and he says, "And I'll hang for it." What Kemmler doesn't realize is that by the time he had committed his crime, New York no longer hanged people.
On that morning in March, William Kemmler has no idea that his actions will qualify him to be the first prisoner executed in the electric chair. And like most of America, Kemmler is also unaware that the man behind his impending execution is one of the world's most respected inventors, Thomas Edison.
Thomas Alva Edison was born on the 11th of February, 1847 in Milan, Ohio, the youngest of seven children. At the age of seven, his family moved to Port Huron, Michigan.
When he was about 12 or so, Edison got a job working on the railway between Port Huron and Detroit. He would sell candy and magazines and books.
Young Edison immediately showed his business sense, setting up a small printing press and publishing his own newspaper, the Weekly Herald. His parallel interest in science was also quick to emerge.
He sets up in this empty area of the baggage room a little chemical laboratory. And one day while he was doing some experiments, he spilled some of this phosphorus, caught the baggage car on fire, and the baggage master was so angry with him that he banged him in the head and boxed his ears a few times.
With his equipment ruined, the young Edison had to start all over again. In 1862, at the age of 15, an accident of fate allowed him to do just that.
One of the telegraph operators had a young son who was out playing in the railway yard, and a car that was unattached somehow started rolling, and Edison scooped the kid out of the way and saved him.
God, oh my God.
As a result, the operator gave Edison special lessons in telegraphy.
In 1863, 16-year-old Edison capitalized on his new skills and joined the ranks of a growing subculture. He became a tramp telegrapher.
Tramp telegraphers were very common. They'd go from job to job, sort of seeing the world. And Edison went from a little drugstore in Port Huron, which had the telegraph office throughout the Midwest, eventually to large cities like Cincinnati. He went down into the South at the end of the Civil War.
By the late 1860s, Thomas Edison was growing tired of the road. He was also beginning to see how his natural science skills and business acumen could be combined to realize his ambitions.
That's when Edison decided that he would give up telegraph operating altogether and devote all of his time to, as he said, bringing out inventions.
In 1870, at the age of 23, Edison moved to New York to seek his fortune. He forged ahead with a string of his own incredible inventions, including the quadruplex telegraph, an advanced telegraph printer, and an early stock ticker. When he sold the rights to the stock ticker for $40,000, Thomas Edison's future was assured.
He decides he needs a little distance. So just in a tiny town called Menlo Park, he decides that he's going to set up his laboratory here. He builds a little factory complex and staffs it with some of the most talented engineers to be found in America.
In New Jersey, Edison makes the extent of his ambitions clear immediately. He promises a minor invention every 10 days and a revolutionary invention every 6 months. Although critics claim he never delivers on this promise, within 5 years, he is America's most prolific inventor.
He skyrocketed to fame with the invention of the phonograph in 1876. That was the period where he really became known as the Wizard of Menlo Park. He was considered a sort of magician because he had created this device that no one had ever conceived of before, a talking machine.
Mary had a little lamb, its fleet was white as snow, and everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go.
2 years later, in 1878, the magician announced his ultimate trick. The idea for the electric light bulb was nothing new. It had been around since 1854. But Edison was the first to build a bulb that worked. His next revolutionary idea was a direct current electrical system, one he hoped would bring light and power to everyone in America.
Edison says the electric light is a wonderful idea, but we need to domesticate it.
Edison knew he'd need more than just a functional light bulb to light the entire country. He'd need a way to distribute the power and keep it safe, as well as working out how to charge customers for using it.
He has to invent new and more powerful generators in order to create the electricity. He has to create systems for conducting this electricity through city streets.
He develops a meter so he can charge people. He's thinking about things like safety fuses so that he can go to the Board of Fire Underwriters and say, electric light is safe.
Finally, after 2 years of development, Edison staged a demonstration for New Yorkers on New Year's Day, 1879, lighting up the outside of his laboratory with electric light.
They have to put extra cars on the Pennsylvania Railroad going between Philadelphia and New York because crowds are pouring into the Menlo Park Laboratory to see this wonderful new technology.
Thomas Edison was now on track to prove that he could light the whole of Manhattan and all of America. But George Westinghouse wouldn't let the public forget about direct current's critical flaw.
When he looked at the direct current system that Edison had installed in New York City, Central Power Station, he kind of identified that the major problem was that you couldn't transmit direct current very far without losing that current off the line.
As far as Edison was concerned, alternating current being showcased by Westinghouse had its flaw as well. If a power line came down, passers-by could be killed.
Westinghouse's alternating current systems were running very powerful currents, 1,000 volts, 2,000 volts. They were running them above city streets, and people were beginning to die.
George Westinghouse's thoughts there were, there are a lot of items out there that can kill people or hurt people, you know, including the streetcars and trains, and it was a risk that had to be accepted because of all the benefits.
In 1878, Edison was presented with a unique opportunity to expose what he saw as the dangers of alternating current when he met a small-time inventor named Harold Brown.
And I have a plan to show the public once and for all just how lethal this type of electricity can be.
Harold P. Brown came out of nowhere, but it was pretty obvious from the very beginning he took a very strong position against Westinghouse alternating current.
Sir, read about the dangers of alternating current, believe me.
Brown had published a number of pamphlets proclaiming the dangers of alternating current. If Harold Brown could design an AC execution device, Edison believed he could discredit Westinghouse without getting his hands dirty.
Harold P. Brown shows up and says, you know what, I agree with you that AC is very unsafe and I want to prove it. I'd like to use your laboratory to do experiments.
Edison provided Brown with equipment and support from his staff. On the 30th of July, 1888, Brown scheduled a public demonstration at Edison's laboratory in New Jersey. He knew there was only one way to make his point. He would demonstrate once and for all just how lethal Westinghouse's AC electricity really was. Thomas Edison believed the public exhibition would clearly show the dangers of alternating current. Death by electrocution was intended to expose the danger of alternating current electricity. Although the electric chair was still on the drawing board, waiting to be built.
When Harold Brown throws the switch, 337 volts of Westinghouse alternating current course through the dog, killing it instantly. Brown has accomplished his goals. He's proven that even small amounts of alternating current can be lethal. And he's kept Edison distanced from the brutal display.
Thomas Edison didn't get up on stage. He did not execute dogs and cats to show how dangerous alternating current was. It was Harold P. Brown that carried those out. But later on, it became apparent that he had backed Harold P. Brown's involvement.
With Edison's help, electricity would become a cutting-edge means of execution as long as the machine to carry it out was completed. Harold Brown set out to design one that would be acceptable to the state of New York, the first state to sanction death by electrocution. His design was a study in simplicity.
It's a good way to immobilize somebody. First thing you have to do if you're going to execute someone is you have to get them tied down somehow, and the chairs work out well for that.
Once seated and strapped in, two electrodes connected to saltwater-soaked sponges are attached directly to the condemned man's skin. The first electrode is placed at the base of the spine, through a hole in the seam of the trousers. The second electrode presses directly against the shaved top of the scalp.
If you want to have a deterrent effect from capital punishment, it has to be horrible in some ways. You had an imposing chair, you strapped the victim in, you had scientists and engineers standing around.
It also has an interesting kind of symbolic connection to this age-old concept of people being struck down by God for their sins. It's literally a man-made lightning bolt.
Another device can also create a man-made lightning bolt.
This is a Tesla coil, a specially designed transformer system that takes the output from a standard wall outlet and boosts it to over 1,000,000 volts. Now, to show me how this works, I'm with a physics professor from the University of California, Santa Cruz, Terry Schalk. How you doing, Terry?
Pretty good.
What are we going to see with a Tesla coil?
We're going to see electricity in the air. It's a demo we take into the schools to show how exciting electricity can be.
Now, Terry, how's this going to work?
You're going to take this sword, you're going to duel with the lightning bolts coming out of here. They'll hit the tip of the sword, come down, go back through this grounding strap to the back end of the Tesla coil. As long as this is in place, you are just fine.
This is my lifeline, and we'll give it a shot.
Here we go. There it goes, it's arcing. Beautiful, but it's deadly.
Whew. The saying electricity in the air is
right.
Very true.
It makes the air sort of explode.
Is that actually what's happening?
Yes, you're heating up the air molecules and they pop just like an ordinary lightning bolt.
Now, what would happen, say, if this did become unattached?
Then the path down to ground would be through you.
And so
you wouldn't like that.
I'd become severely injured, if not dead.
Potentially.
This is essentially what happens when a person is strapped into the electric chair. The condemned prisoner is added to the 1,000-volt live circuit and essentially becomes a human filament in a huge, deadly light bulb.
There's no blood, there's no screaming. It's like a miracle.
In an instant, the electrical impulses of the body's nerves are overridden, shutting down the heart and respiratory system and damaging the brain. Supporters maintain the shock occurs faster than the body's ability to feel pain, a claim that has never been proved.
Even to this day, it does not appear that it's a painless, easy way to execute a condemned prisoner.
But where the efficient transmission of electrical energy was concerned, there was no controversy about alternating current's advantages. It could be transferred over very long distances and carried over smaller, cheaper wires.
What alternating current opens up is the possibility of hydropower, of using the tremendous force of water to generate electricity, and then you can transmit it for hundreds of miles to the cities where you need it.
Edison understood the basic strengths of alternating current, but was committed to the technology of his own invention.
He had his system, and it was clearly a system he had created and that he could dominate. The problem was he could never dominate AC in the same way, and so Edison had no incentive personally to move into AC technology.
The Edison company focused on the one problem they could find with alternating current systems: the ability to transmit power at very high voltages over long distances meant that AC power lines carried lethal loads. For Edison, this would be AC's Achilles heel.
Edison genuinely believes that alternating current is more dangerous than direct. He worries that if alternating current is allowed to spread across the country, it will kill people and that will damage the industry.
By now, Thomas Edison has spent over 2 years trying to demonstrate the dangers of alternating current. but in October of 1889, one incident will do more to terrify the public of Westinghouse's high-voltage AC than any orchestrated demonstration ever could.
John Feeks was a lineman whose job this morning in October of 1889 was to climb a pole and cut away some dead, abandoned telegraph wires. The only truly dangerous wires are the high-voltage power lines that run fairly low on the pole. Once he gets past those, he thinks he's home free, so then it's just a question of sort of weaving his way through this web of wires up to the position that he needs to be. When he gets there, he braces himself against one of the crossbars and begins his work.
But it wasn't a routine day for New York City lineman John Feeks. A few blocks away, a downed high-voltage AC power line had crossed one of his abandoned telegraph lines. He had no idea that within inches of his face lurked 1,000 volts of certain death. October 1889. High above the streets of New York City, fate was about to present a horrifying public exhibition, one that would unwittingly help America's most famous inventor. Thomas Edison was just inches away from winning the battle to wire America with his direct current, and death by electrocution was once again illustrating the dangers of his rival's technology. The electric chair was all part of Edison's plan to forever associate Westinghouse's alternating current with death.
High up on a New York City telegraph pole, lineman John Feeks is on a routine job cutting abandoned wires. To keep his balance, Feeks reaches for a nearby wire to steady himself, as he has 100 times before.
Now, this, in most circumstances, would be perfectly safe because that would have been a telegraph wire, which has a negligible voltage on it. But somewhere, a couple blocks away, that particular telegraph wire had gotten crossed with a high-voltage power line. He was killed almost immediately.
Though Feeks's death was a quick one, the grisly display seemed to last forever. The body of John Feeks sizzled on the web of wires for over an hour before rescuers managed to cut him loose.
There were thousands of people who actually saw this man dead above the streets. There were hundreds of thousands more who read about it in the newspaper and saw the pictures. And it suddenly brought home what Thomas Edison had been warning them about for a couple of years.
What followed in New York City came to be known as the Great Electrical Panic of 1889. People began to rip electrical wires from their homes, fearing that even a simple door buzzer could be the conduit for a fatal jolt of electricity. Almost overnight, a quarter of New York's wired infrastructure had been destroyed.
There were reports that people were throwing out their telephones, that they were stripping out their systems, that they were so scared that electricity would kill them that they didn't want to have anything to do with it.
The electrical panic dies down without leaving any lasting damage, but there's still one hurdle preventing New York from adopting the electric chair. In 1889, the state convenes a hearing to determine if Kemmler's electrocution would truly be painless and humane. The fate of the chair will be decided in the courtroom.
All rise. Honorable Judge Stone presiding.
George Westinghouse, when he became aware of the hearings that were being held, sent a well-known attorney to represent the Westinghouse interest to try to stop this from happening.
You may be seated.
Clearly, regardless of what was going on in New York State, in reality, this was about who was right, Edison or Westinghouse.
Famous New York lawyer W. Bort Cochran presented the case against the electric chair. The pro-electrocution interests were represented by expert witness Harold Brown, the inventor who'd conducted the public animal executions at Edison's laboratories.
Sirs, I appeal to your sense of humanity and your respect for science. Let me assure you that, through painstaking research and scores of animal tests, there can be no question but to accept that alternating current is, in fact, lethal to everyone.
I must object, sir. How can you possibly state that adequate research has been conducted?
When questioned, Brown denied having any relationship to Edison. But while Brown's case for electrical execution was strong, the court was unable to come to a decision on his word alone. Thomas Edison was called to the stand.
Do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Take the stand, please.
When Edison appears, it's a moment. Right? Here is the great inventor himself, right, who's going to finally, once and for all, tell us what the truth is about this new technology.
I feel confident, based on observed research, that intermittent current, such as that employed by Mr. Westinghouse, would cause instantaneous and painless death.
Nobody knew what to believe until Edison took the stand, and his authority was so great that he helped convince the courts that electrocution should go ahead.
Execution by electrocution is the most humane, the safest, and the most practical method that we know of today. And it is the future.
He carried the day. There's no doubt about it. His testimony really was a very strong point for carrying out executions using electricity.
The electric chair's last hurdle had finally been cleared. But the process itself, death by electricity, had yet to be named. The Edison lawyer had a suggestion.
He proposes the term Westinghoused, as in the prisoner was Westinghoused this morning, or to Westinghouse someone. And he said that it would be a fitting tribute to the public services of this distinguished man.
And when George Westinghouse heard about them suggesting that term, he was very upset. He had thought that definitely was a very low level, a level which George Westinghouse would not lower himself to compete. George Westinghouse was rather appalled and considered it to be very underhanded.
After years of experimentation and planning, Edison will finally see the dangers of Westinghouse's alternating current truly demonstrated. A single moment may determine the winner of this deadly game to control the electricity of a nation.
Martin Bell, best be up. Your guests are starting to arrive.
The 6th of August, 1890. The day of the first electric chair execution had arrived. After 448 days on death row, condemned axe murderer William Kemmler dressed in his finest outfit. Kemmler had developed a friendly relationship with the sympathetic prison staff.
Looking sharp, Bill.
Thanks.
You ready?
Yep.
Have a seat, then. Okay, now you sit still for a moment.
Don't make me look the fool. I want to do this right.
Kemmler's head was shaved clean to increase conductivity.
Look like a man of the cloth. Oh, one more thing.
Then his trousers were cut down the middle, so an electrode could be secured at the base of his spine.
All right, then. That should be it. God be with you, Bill.
At 6:35 a.m., the last of the 25 secretly invited witnesses arrived. Present among them was Alfred Southwick, the Buffalo dentist who had originally contacted Thomas Edison with the idea for electrical execution. One chair, however, remained empty. Thomas Edison had been invited, but chose not to attend.
He didn't believe in the death penalty, and ultimately, I think he regretted having been involved.
Warden Charles Durston called the official physician to the side.
They were immediately presented with a problem that no one had ever been electrocuted before in an electric chair, so they didn't know quite how much electricity to send through, how long it would take.
Maybe 15 seconds.
That seems like an awfully long time.
Or maybe 10 seconds then. Does anyone have a timepiece?
Warden Durston then began the solemn walk down the hall to retrieve William Kemmler.
I hereby declare, by the powers entrusted to me by the state of New York, my intention to enforce this warrant of death upon William Kemmler.
Kemmler remained calm.
All right, I'm ready.
All right then, Bill. We best be going.
On the day of William Kemmler's execution, he was led into a chamber. There were a couple dozen people in there.
With no precedent set for electrocutions, Warden Charles Durston improvised the procedure.
Now, gentlemen, this is William Kemmler. I have read to him the death warrant, and I have told him he has got to die. Have you anything to say?
Good luck to everybody in the world. And I'm going to a better place.
Amen.
Amen.
Would you leave forward, Bill?
He had electrodes attached both to the base of his spine, at the time they had considered that the best place to put it, and to the top of his head, and the top of his head had been shaved so the electrode could fit there.
Could you cinch this up real tight? I want to do a good job of it.
This won't hurt, Bill. It won't hurt a bit.
Over 1,000 volts coursed instantly through William Kemmler's body.
And the current stays on for 17 seconds.
That's it. Turn off the current. He's dead.
They cut off the current, and Kemmler slumped in his chair, and Alfred Southwick, who was present, was very pleased with the outcome.
Unmistakable evidence of death.
This is the culmination of 10 years hard work and study. We live in a higher civilization today.
Everyone was relieved that it was over until Kemmler starts gasping again.
God, he's not dead!
We must do something!
In a horrifying twist of fate, the death chamber demonstration that Edison was counting on to hand in victory had backfired. William Kemmler was still very much alive. On the 6th of August, 1890, officials in Auburn Prison, upstate New York, conducted the world's first electrical execution as America's most famous inventor tensely awaited the outcome. Although Thomas Edison didn't believe in the death penalty, he had lent his support to its newest tool. The electrocution of axe murderer William Kemmler was supposed to expose the danger of alternating current, once and for all. The electric chair was designed to ruin George Westinghouse, but only if it functioned as intended.
The execution of William Kemmler has gone dreadfully wrong. After a 17-second burst of 1,000 volts, Kemmler is left horribly injured, but alive.
Throw it! Throw it again!
They very hurriedly turn the current on again, and this time, just so there's no doubt about it, they leave the current on for probably a couple minutes, and all the confusion, nobody really kept the time. There was smoke and burning, and several people had to leave the room, and someone vomited, and it was a horrid scene. Finally dead, it's believed William Kemmler had been subjected to 2 full minutes at 1,000 volts. There's a high degree of incompetence all around on this. It's in essence killing by cooking. Newspapers ignored a ban on printing details of the electrocution. The New York Herald claimed Kemmler suffered the same fate as lineman John Feeks, who was slowly roasted to death.
Good morning, Mr. Edison.
Good morning.
It was actually a debacle.
Edison immediately took charge of damage control.
Well, gentlemen, I can assure you that the next procedure will be accomplished instantly, and without the scene at Auburn today.
Edison's pronouncement remained unproven. On the 7th of July, 1891, 4 murderers on Sing Sing's death row were executed by the electric chair. A press gag order prevented the reporting of the results.
They thought on balance that it had gone pretty well. It worked out in the end. He was dead, and so they proceeded to electrocute many hundreds of others in that same New York execution chamber.
The electric chair is presented as being quick, painless, clean. It never turns out to be that. But in some ways, you could say that that was actually part of its appeal.
Like the technology that powers it, electrocution spread across the nation. Thomas Edison had helped to make it a part of American culture. Privately, his experience with the electric chair was a chapter of his life Edison wanted to forget.
Edison, however, looking back on this event, ultimately regrets, I think, in some respects, what happened. He later says that, you know, his biggest mistake was, in fact, promoting electrocution in the electric chair.
In the great battle of the currents, Kemmler's execution had no real impact. American consumers didn't buy the AC death connection. An alternating current proved to be a much more viable technology overall. In 1892, Edison's company merged with an alternating current firm to create General Electric.
When we look at the battle of the currents, it's apparent today and very well documented that George Westinghouse won the battle of the currents.
Edison is remembered more for his dictaphone, the mimeograph, the kinetoscope, and for making the world's first motion picture.
Edison's participation in the creation of the electric chair in the long run has very little effect on his legacy. In his official 2-volume biography that came out during his lifetime, the episode isn't dealt with at all. I found one newspaper clip in which a reporter asked him if he had invented the electric chair, and Edison says, "I did not invent any such machine."
Through the course of the 20th century, over 4,400 men and 24 women were executed by the electric chair. Today, the chair is still legal in 6 states. Thomas Alva Edison died of old age at 9 p.m. on the 18th of October, 1931, in New Jersey. He was 84 years old. As a symbol of his tenacity, 1,600 customers in New York City continue to receive Con Edison direct current today. While his status as the greatest inventor of the 20th century is seldom challenged, his memory continues to be tarnished by the secrecy and backroom dealings that characterized his war with George Westinghouse.
When legendary inventor Thomas Edison sets out to be the one to bring electricity to America, he embarks on a journey that will lead to an unlikely destination. With the flip of a switch in a New York prison, the nation has changed forever. Once again, the M3 factor plays a powerful role in history, one we'll continue to examine on Man, Moment, Machine.